Hey YouTube, Joyboy here. So, One Piece chapter 982 is out. So if you haven't checked out that chapter yet, I suggest that you do so because I will be spoiling you. Now that you have, let's begin. You know, it seems so long ago that there was a time in One Piece that I thought to myself, huh, Wano's going pretty easy. We might actually still be at that phase right now, to be honest. It ain't gonna last much longer. I can tell you that for sure. But what I think hasn't changed, Oda trolling on her matchup predictions. Who out there guessed Page 1 and Ulti versus Luffy? Let's be honest. If anyone's raising their hands out there, they're a liar. I'm actually fine with this fight if it happens. I like the dynamic between Page 1 and Ulti. I find the relationship interesting, and simultaneously I like the potential dynamic between Ulti and Luffy. And I'm ready to see just where Luffy is and where the Flying Six are. In terms of power scaling. You know, it's finally time we put all that power scaling work to good use. I can just imagine fan hats out there across the world pulling out their notepads, their spreadsheets, pie charts, or Venn diagrams, putting that calculus to good use in preparation, you know, to take them power scaling W's. I really hope that it pays off for someone out there, because I am just not too sure how all this will go. On one hand, my thought is, you know, this is a good warm-up, and I think that most would probably agree, or at least that seems like the consensus first reaction. Luffy has fought a top tier commander on Big Mom's crew, as well as the third tier commander. In the span of about 60 or so chapters, he seems to be closer to mastering advanced armament and observation hockey. He's been called the fifth Yonko of the Sea by the papers. You know, he intends on fighting Kaido and Big Mom, so this better be a warm up, right? All these net gains gotta be for something. But on the other hand, I am really, honestly not sure at all. All of Luffy's fights since Doflamingo have been high difficulty. Against Cracker, does he win without Nami's help? Legitimate question. He then lost to an army of Big Mom's children, and then he should have lost to Katakuri, but I believe Katakuri gave him opportunities to keep fighting and prove his will. I don't think that I consider the fight against Hold'em or the sumo guy, I don't even remember his name, a fight worthy of mentioning at all. Which, as a side note, where is that sumo guy? He's then crushed by Kaido. And given the opportunity for all sorts of significant fights in the prison, we don't really see it. Guys, Luffy is undoubtedly stronger, but by how much? And we kind of assume the strength of the Flying Six, but how accurate is that? Soon enough, we're gonna have to find out. If this really is a 2-versus-1, this could test him, and force him to try harder than he wants to with so much fighting left to do. And let's be real, any fighting that he does at all right now, he is surrounded by enemies, it's going to draw attention and potentially lead to others joining or interfering. If you remember Big Mom's crew, you had Sweet Commander similar to Kaido's All-Stars. We know the Flying Six are just below the All-Stars, so the strongest of Big Mom's children who are not Sweet Commanders should be some kind of equivalent, you would think. So a question then is, do you think Luffy could take both Daifuku and Perosperos, some combination of characters like that, at the same time without suffering too much damage? This isn't a rhetorical question, it's a legit question. What do you guys think? I don't know. But on the plus side, I do view Ulti and Page 1 as weaker members of the Flying Six. But either way, I'm kind of in wait and see mode in regards to where exactly Luffy stands right now. If Oda wants to, he can make this fight high diff. So not really what I would call a warm-up. Just after Luffy takes damage from Apu, all in an effort to make us and Luffy himself realize just how screwed they all are at this moment. I wouldn't put it past him. So yeah, my first reaction, good warm-up here. My second reaction is maybe this is an unexpected challenge. But if I had to say, if I had a vote, my body is absolutely ready for that rubber flex. I hope Oda lets Luffy show off just a little bit before reality has to hit. But this, of course, might assume that this fight happens at all or is more than just simply a skirmish. We still got a lot of arc left and many things could happen. And even in this chapter, Oda demonstrates that he just kind of throws things out there as red herrings to keep us guessing and keep the tension going. Things are happening, but they haven't happened quite yet. You guys get what I mean. With how Luffy and Ulti looked at each other, I just got a strange feeling. I've heard others mention the very same thing. Ulti might develop a thing for Luffy. If your harem don't grow, then you can never become the Pirate King, and that's a fact. Listen, as I bestow upon you the wisdom of my power scaling. This is an anime made in Japan, come on. In a battle of top tiers, you gotta compare your women first. And I think that Black Marie and Boa Hancock is a draw. So Luffy's gotta get an edge somewhere. But jokes aside, I'm curious how all the Flying Six roles will play out. I'm absolutely not discounting one or multiple turning against Kaido at some point. And if you guys in the comments say X Drake, I'm just going to end you. Instant ban. But yeah, I am just glad that Marco is here. I really am. You know, he's earned that cred in my mind that whenever he speaks, I kind of fanboy a little. I can't help it. And this chapter reminded me how excited I am for him to acknowledge Luffy and the Straw Hats and their accomplishment and where they started and where they are now. To me, that'd mean a lot. Last he saw of Luffy, you know, he was but a lad who needed to be watched over and protected. But now, you know, he's a man who needs to be watched over and protected. A lot has changed. I could just imagine that interaction, you know, making me tear up a bit. I thought it was interesting how Oda explained what happened with Marco. As they say, you can always count on Oda in a 1-1 against any theory. I don't think that anyone predicted that Marco always intended to come and join the Alliance, but late. Just another reminder, guys, Oda plays with us always. Looking back at the message now, it was very intentionally deceptive, but in a clever way. Honestly, though, it makes me wonder what exactly Marco was waiting for. Why was he delayed? I mean, we have the presence of Weevil or the idea of Weevil, so maybe he felt like he could deal with Weevil and then join the Alliance afterwards? Or is this something else entirely and Oda has an ace up his sleeve? My fanboy headcanon is Marco went to go find Shanks or some other ally because they had time. And if not Marco, the Nekomamushi is in play here as well. I just kind of want Shanks, man. Is that asking for too much? Maybe. But it's stated that Marco and Nekomamushi did not travel together, but both are late. Why was Nekomamushi late? Unlike Marco, Oda gave us nothing here. So, you know, I'm trying to control my expectations, but I'm a little bit excited about the possibility, not gonna lie. I know they say, well, Nekomamushi is always late, this is normal. But based on how I understand the character right now, I doubt he would have been this late on purpose without having spent his time wisely. I do wonder how Marco, and we assume Izo in the last chapter, if that was Izo, you know, I kind of wonder how Marco got here. There's lots of chatter about whether the Marco Beard Pirates are here or not, you know, like the other members such as Vista or Jozu. In this chapter, we see Marco on Nekomamushi's ship, and he could have probably flown himself from where he was to Wano. But I really doubt that he carried Izo. Although the image in my mind is kind of funny. Izo doing his makeup, are we there yet? Meanwhile, Marco, the epitome of suffering. So I see people saying, well, this seems to confirm that it's just Izo and Marco, but I'm not too sure. I think that we're still kind of waiting on the reveal of Marco's ship to be 100%. This chapter gave us a little more to build a headcanon that Kondro may have held back quite a lot in regards to the scabbards. You know, I don't really know where everybody stands on this idea as a community, but for me, Kondro is redeemed somewhat by the end of this arc. That is my preferred mindset. In this chapter, Oda drops this line, still. If Kondro really is so trustworthy, and he says that he's heard nothing, then Odin really didn't give them any clues to Laugh Tale. This line's logic reads as follows. Kondro is trustworthy if Odin didn't give them clues to Laugh Tale. Or maybe Kondro is trustworthy if he doesn't know of any clues to Laugh Tale. But going back to what is actually said, it's technically true. Nothing we have seen seems to suggest Odin told the Scabbards anything at all in regards to the things that he knew. However, it's kind of a lie of omission. Kondro does actually have some intel in regards to Laugh Tale that Kaido and Orochi would not know. The Road Poneglyph and Zo. Because he knows that and has not told Kaido it does not appear, then by Kaido's definition, essentially, Kondro is not trustworthy. I think that you have to assume Kondro is either painfully literal, and when asked a direct question, always gives a direct answer with no sense of the general meaning of the question, which quite honestly would be a hilarious character quirk. Nothing goes over my head. I am too fast. I would catch it. Or he purposefully kept the Road Poneglyph secret, because he wasn't specifically asked and didn't need to lie. Has Odin told you anything of Laugh Tale? No, Odin hasn't. But that doesn't mean I don't know things. He tells this lie because he holds no desire to set Kaido on Zou. That makes a lot of sense to me, just conceptually. I don't think Kondro is as evil as even he believes himself to be. He may hold a grudge against the Kozuki, but probably not the Minks. There may actually be a feeling soul in there somewhere Oda is preparing to reveal. Another line caught my attention as well. Kondro's life as an actor will soon be over. This is almost like reiterated, because we already knew this from chapters in the past, and through the reiteration it becomes even more interesting. This easily could have a double meaning. His role as a Red Scabbard and an ally of the Kozuki, and his role as the loyal spy of Orochi could soon be over, because neither could be who Kondro really is, and he was an actor in both. But on the other hand, you have Orochi and Momonosuke in this chapter. I am really glad that Oda didn't take the route of Momo freeing himself with the dagger. Again, Oda is just playing with our expectations right now, waiting for the moment to carry that momentum somewhere significant. This may sound kind of brutal, but I hope Momonosuke gets crucified. That sounds pretty bad. You know, I don't want him to suffer, but I want him to suffer. You know, for his character growth and to have a chance to earn Wano's respect. As he is now, and if he were to be pampered or kept hidden, I don't think that he could do that. If Orochi makes a spectacle, Momonosuke has the opportunity for an Odin-like moment. I was born to boil, you know, Momonosuke, I was born to be crucified, baby. And just as the Odin moment in the past had a profound effect on the people of Wano, this could simultaneously do the exact same thing. The Alliance has infiltrated Onigashima, they have on disguises. You know, they could end up witnessing this without drawing attention to themselves. I've read a lot of Kingdom, alright? He gets treated like this, but in some way defies it. That's going to be a massive morale boost and power up for the Alliance. I could see that happening, and all of this leads to the idea, the plot, of Momo earning enough respect to be worthy of the title of Shogun, living in his father's footsteps, and making that plot interesting. Orochi, though, is just straight scum. Top 5 most hateable characters in One Piece easily. Anytime he shows up and says anything or does anything of significance, I feel exactly, you know, the same way. He's right up there with Spand and Wapple and Charlos. Crucifying a little boy just to satisfy your lack of a proper nutsack. Let's just call it as it is. I am eager for the moment somebody makes him squeal. I just think that it's worth pointing out, Orochi and Kaido's relationship and communication seems shallow at best. I get the impression, and maybe the official will clarify some of these things differently. As always, we wait for the official before we 100% believe whatever we see in a chapter. But I get the impression Kaido does not know that this samurai traveled through time. He seems, you know, confused that Momonosuke looks no different. My guy, it's been 6 months. People don't grow like that. And then you have Orochi's scheme against the Alliance in the first place, which seems like a solo effort, and he didn't really consult Kaido about that. I also don't think that he told Kaido that the Alliance had arrived originally in Wano either, as Kaido didn't seem to be expecting Luffy, at least not at that moment. I also don't think that Orochi has revealed his threat he made to Cipherpole and the world government. I've got Kaido at my back, try whatever you want. I'm interested to see where this concept might end up, if it is the case, you know, and become important enough to explicitly reveal. I don't think that Orochi is plotting against Kaido, but I do think that Orochi is desperate to prove how worthy he is as a dictator of Wano. And being unworthy, as he obviously is, he will fail spectacularly in some way. And I guess that just leaves us with Denjiro, the Neck God, and Sasaki. I think that a lot of people are a little disappointed Sasaki was done this way, but for me, Denjiro needs more feats, so I'm completely fine with it. For me, this is Oda's way of saying Sasaki isn't even worthy of brushing Denjiro's sack hair. And based on his neck alone, that feels like legit scaling to me. You can take my criteria, it's fine. But I personally want to put Denjiro up there with, you know, the number one Yonko commanders and somebody like King, I really do. We saw Ashura Doji fight on par with Jack in the present timeline, or close enough to be satisfied. And in the past, Doji and Denjiro fought Kaido and had Kaido impressed. To me, Doji seems like he might be a little weaker than he was in the past, as he kind of lost hope in fighting for the good guys and maybe got a little bit lazy, comparatively. Whereas Denjiro might actually be even stronger than he was 20 years in the past, having spent these last 20 years with nothing but revenge on his mind. So a guy like Sasaki might be wasted on Denjiro. At the same time, Sasaki will probably get freed at some point and pose a threat to somebody else or used in some other way. But yeah, I guess that just leaves us with one more thing that we need to discuss from this chapter. Big Mom and most of the Straw Hats and Carrot and Shinobu. So yeah, it was pretty obvious that she wasn't going to become an ally after the last chapter. That didn't make any sense. And Oda chose the route of Big Mom being an imminent threat. But at the same time, she's not a threat because Chopper and Usopp can distract her and get away with it. I mean, guys, this is the reality, right? Nami saw Big Mom chase after Usopp and Chopper, was concerned for a moment, then was like, whatever. It's Big Mom. Whatever. They'll figure it out, probably. Meanwhile, where did Sanji go? Too depressed to notice Big Mom. Absolutely the funniest thing not in the chapter. I mean, I'm going to say this for as often as we see potentially Big Mom interact with Chopper, that is my aim. I want for Big Mom and Chopper and the Straw Hats to interact, and I want to see what comes of that story. I think, you know, week after week, people are so disappointed with the Big Mom Pirates. I mean, people probably aren't even disappointed anymore. It's become the norm. And because this is the direction that Oda has chosen to take with Big Mom's character, and it's only till now that you realize, like this was intentional. It's not that Oda failed to make Big Mom hype, it's that this is the kind of character and the kind of storytelling and writing that he intended to do. All this tells you is that Big Mom's role in the story is likely going to be different than what you think that it is going to be. She is not being set up as the big bad, and there's a lot of potential there. But I guess I'm going to stick with my guns from the last chapter. I really do think that Big Mom is going to collect Chopper, so at some point in time she's going to capture the tank. Maybe she doesn't realize Usopp is there. It seems totally in character for Usopp to be like, you know, back against the wall. I'm not here. Shoo, shoo, monster. So then Big Mom captures Chopper and then sort of collects him while still seeking revenge against the Straw Hats until, you know, we can further, delve into that story. As for Prometheus, though, and then Nami and Shinobu and Carrot, that's really interesting to me, too. Because we know through Big Mom's hat Napoleon, she can communicate with her other homies, Prometheus, so then she would know where they are too. I just kind of have a feeling that through Shinobu, Carrot, and Nami's abilities, they're going to escape Prometheus. And the idea here really is to sort of start delving into, you know, where does Zeus stand right now? And the best way to do that would have him interact with Prometheus. Is he an enemy who's been reporting the Straw Hats' movements to Big Mom? Or is he an ally who just kind of is going with the flow and hoping that Big Mom doesn't ever really, find him. I could see an argument for both sides. Again, this is just another element of this chapter that I'm not sure is more than transient. More, that it's going to be a moment leading to one particular thing, but it's not really a matchup per se. But yeah, I'm curious. This chapter I thought was really, really good. Enjoyed the whole chapter with the exception of Law and his damn map of the whirlpools to Wano. I don't need to see this map anymore. But as always, guys, I'm curious as to what you guys have to say. If you notice something from the chapter that I might have missed, just share your thoughts. Like the video if you like the video, dislike the video if you dislike the video, subscribe if you want to be notified for my future content. And as always, guys, have a wonderful day.